Morning, everybody. It's great to have each and every one of you joining us here today. Welcome to those that are visiting, those that call Asbury home, and those that are watching online. A couple quick announcements to get the service started off. Advent booklets are available at the back of the sanctuary. There is also a link that was sent out and Pastor Brent's looking forward to Sunday. If you would like an electronic copy of this. The Advent booklet begins on Sunday, December 1st this year. Asbury Christmas dinner. It is the most wonderful time of the year. It is coming up, happening on this Wednesday, the 27th. We just ask that, if possible, a suggested donation of $10 per person or $5 for children ages 6 and under. For that night. Space is limited. We still have some spots left, so if you are interested in coming to this and haven't signed up yet, you can call into the church office or you can go onto the Asbury.ca website, and there's a link there to get you signed up for that. As just sticking with the Christmas dinner quickly, those that are helping on that night, if you are a server, if you're helping in the kitchen, or if you're a greeter, we ask that you arrive for 5 p.m. so that we can get everything straightened out for that night. So if you are helping, 5 p.m., just so we can get some directions on that. Men's breakfast is going to be happening on November 30th at 8 a.m. here at the church. A special speaker from Silver Lake Wesleyan Camp is going to be Dave Mason. Sorry. So come on out, men, for another amazing breakfast where you're going to be fed and challenged. United Worship Christmas Night, Sunday, December 1st at 6 p.m., happening at Rideau Christian Fellowship. It'll be featuring Joel Williams and Stefan Schilke. So that will be happening on the 1st of December. Our biannual business meeting is happening on Tuesday, December 3rd. We ask that you arrive for 6:30 for pie. That's always a great way to start a meeting. Maybe we could start doing that with Sunday service. So pie at 6:30. The meeting will begin at 7. All are welcome to attend. It's just that if there's anything that comes up that requires voting, it's only those that are members are able to vote on this. And junior youth. Junior youth is going to be happening on November 29th, 6 p.m. We'll be having a movie night, and this movie night is going to be happening at my place. So 36 McLean Boulevard. Don't forget to bring your hats, mitts, and scarves that we're doing for donations to the YAC for that. And also for that night for watching the movie, if you have a special blankie or pillow that you like to cuddle up with while watching a movie, come bring that as well. So that's for junior youth. And the final announcement we have is actually going to be a video announcement, and it is from for the Mountain of Food.
I just wanted to thank my faithful volunteers, some that have been doing this right from the start, 17 years, some just as much, And you're a faithful bunch. I really, really appreciate you, and I'm sure the food bank does too. It all goes right back to our community, what we do today, just for a couple hours. Thanks again, and I hope to see you again next year.
I believe that there was a record amount of donations given and food collected. So I think your volunteers, you deserve a round of applause. Hey, I'm so glad you're here today. You know, you're welcome. You come as you are, no perfect people allowed. We come as we are before God, and we remember that God is good and He wants to meet us exactly where we're at. Let's open in prayer. Lord, thank you so much for this time together. I'm asking by your Spirit that you would speak to each person here. Open our hearts to what you want to say. Help us to worship. Help us to express our hearts to you. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
It is a privilege to be able to gather together and to worship together. Each person present here today is looking for a word from the Lord. Richard Foster said in a book, worship is our response to the overtures of love from the heart of God. So would you join with me this morning with standing? Join the angels, celestial beings saying, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Please stand together. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise from Revelation 5:12.
Awestruck wonder at the mention of your song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Asbury kids, if you could come forward. Great to see you this morning. Next Sunday is the first Sunday of Advent, which means it's Sunday where we prepare for Christmas. And I understand that you guys are going to be helping us out with the services, so this is going to be awesome. So you're going to go to Sunday school today, and then for the next few weeks, you're going to help us out with service. So I appreciate that. Let me pray for you. Lord, thank you so much for these kids who are growing up to know you and find out about you. I pray that they would learn to love you, and Lord, that you would help them to grow up in love and peace, grace, truth. And Lord, I ask your blessing on their teachers as well. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
A thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. All thrones And if you've been forgiven, and if you've been redeemed, sing the song forever to the Lamb. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear His name, sing the song forever to the Lamb. We'll sing the song forever and amen. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever.
Hear your people.
Hear your people sing.
If you have a need for yourself or you're carrying a burden for someone else, we invite you to symbolically come and lay it before the Lord. God answers prayer, and He's good. So come as we sing this next verse.
I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God.
Lord, we're before you and we thank you that you are so good. Lord, we acknowledge that you're good even when life isn't. And so, Lord, I pray for those four people who have come forward this morning carrying a burden for themselves or a burden for people they care about. I'm praying, Lord, that you would come into each one of those situations represented here. And Lord, that you would bring whatever is needed to bear on those situations, whether it's wisdom or finances or a fresh move of your spirit or a way through. I'm praying, Lord, for comfort and strength for those who need it as well. Lord, we all have needs. We would, in these moments, lay them before you. Thank you, Lord, that you're always, always faithful. Lord, there's a lot happening in the next few weeks around Asbury. I'm praying that you would come and inhabit each one of those events so that you would receive glory and honor. Lord, our church is about you. And so, Lord, I'm praying that you would have your way in our church. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down and surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me.
Our scripture reading this morning is found in Psalm 32. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them, and in whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night my hand was heavy on me. My strength was zapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave me the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all the faithful pray to you while you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach them. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. Do not be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding and must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one who trusts in him. Rejoice in the Lord. Be glad, you righteous. Sing, all you are upright in heart.
Rejoice in the Lord now and always. Sing it.
lay your requests at his feet.
His peace will fall upon us to guard our hearts and minds. In Christ who reigns eternal, shepherd of our lives, with each hand he's given. Praise the Lord, in these times we live in, we will praise the Lord throughout every season. I am sure we have every reason to praise the Lord.
Rejoice in the Lord now and always, tell of the good he has done. Worship the Lord to remember all of the joy yet to come.
The hope that burns within us, the dark cannot destroy. With praise that's never ending, we say again, rejoice. With each breath that is given, praise the Lord. In these times we live in, we will praise the Lord throughout.
Father, I ask as we look at your word this morning that you would both inspire us and help us to see who we are in you. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you have your Bibles, smartphones, tablets, want to follow along, Psalm 32 is what we're looking at today. I was listening to Kevin do the announcements. We need a novel just to publish what's going on around here in the next couple of weeks. But hey, it's all good. I'm hoping that you'll be able to participate. This is the last of our series titled Psalms for Your Life. And I think through the series, you've got the feeling of why the Psalms have become so beloved. They have a way of expressing our hearts to God. They have a way of expressing our feelings. But then you also see God's heart for his people. Next week, we're going to start into our Advent series, Finding Jesus is what it will be called. And we're going to talk about finding Jesus in unexpected people, in unexpected times, in unexpected circumstances, and in unexpected places. So we'll walk through the Christmas story together doing that. If you have some friends who you've been talking to about Jesus, this is going to be a great series for you to invite them to church. So I would encourage you to do that over the Advent season. Today we're looking at Psalm 32. Psalm 32, it's characterized in a number of different ways. It could be characterized as what they call a penitential psalm, a psalm of confession. It could be characterized as a wisdom psalm. It could be characterized as a psalm of thanksgiving. However we want to characterize it, I think it's a great psalm for which us to end our series on and use it as a jumping point into communion. If you're watching online and you want to celebrate communion with us, I would encourage you to gather the elements, bread and juice. If you don't have that, water and crackers, just something that you can symbolically walk along communion with us. We'll be celebrating that at the end of the service, and I invite you to do that. Have you ever come to a place in your life where you know you've sinned against God, but you really don't want to deal with it? You rationalize your sin away, oh, it wasn't really that bad. You really don't want to confess it because if I confess it, well, then I'll have to stop doing that, and I don't want to stop doing that. You're tired, and you do your best to You tried your best to ignore it and forget about it. Well, that's where David, the author of this psalm, finds himself at the beginning of this. David, the author of this psalm, found himself after committing adultery with Bathsheba, and then arranging the circumstances for her husband to be killed. Some of you will hear me say often, you know, come as you are, no perfect people allow. The reason why we can say that is because, well, a number of the people in the Bible were, at one point in their lives, not great people. The Bible talks about imperfect people who are transformed. David in the psalm, he's reflecting back on what God has done for him. He's reflecting on his life now. And he pens the psalm. I suspect that many of you can echo the voice of David as we walk through the psalm today. I want to encourage you to locate where you fit in this psalm. Where is it that you most identify with? And I think that may help you in terms of knowing how to take your next step spiritually. Come with me to Psalm 32, verse 1. Blessed. Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them and in whose spirit is no deceit. The psalm starts out blessed. Translators could have easily translated that happy, and some translations do. There's a sense of being highly favored by divine grace. If you want to live the blessed life, if you want to see happiness in this life, you got to take note of this psalm. In these first two verses, I find it interesting. David uses three different words in the Hebrew language to describe sin. He also uses three different words to describe forgiveness. First word he uses to describe sin is transgressions. In the New International Version, it's translated transgressions in the New International Version. It has the idea of, you know, when one party breaks its contract with another party, it has the idea of a child rebelling against its parent. Blessed is the one whose transgressions, whose rebellion is forgiven. Whose sin is covered is the next second word he uses, and it carries with it the series of doing something forbidden or ignoring something that's required by God, God's law or his character. What we know is sin. In verse 2, the word psalmist uses sin again. NIV translates it sin. Other translations use the word iniquity. Comes from the idea of being guilty, of depravity, of perversity, or of crime. Blessed is the one whose rebellions are forgiven, whose sin and guilt are covered. Blessed is the one whose crimes against the Lord do not count against them. David is saying, happy is the one who's not rebelling against God and whose life is on track and whose life is marked by honesty. He's saying the person who is happy knows what it means to be forgiven. He or she has their sins covered, removed, justified by God. God is not holding their sin against them. I know a lot of you can echo that sentiment. You know what it means to walk in forgiveness, to have your sins forgiven by God. There is a sense of joy and of happiness in that. David tells us that he felt the weight of his sin, but he's looking back now when he was released from that weight, and he says, "Ah, it's good." Maybe that's where you find yourself in this psalm today. You're reveling in God's salvation of you. You're celebrating his goodness because, well, you know that you've been forgiven. I remember walking with a woman who paid her way through university by selling her body. Then she found Jesus. And she described it as a weight being lifted of a freedom. There was something good that she found in Jesus that just allowed her to have the sense of, wow, happy is the one whose sin is forgiven. Every so often, though, I'll run into people who think they've been too bad for God. David was saying this after adultery, after murder. And if God can forgive the murderers and adulterers and prostitutes, he can forgive you. You know what the worst sin ever committed was? It was when they nailed Jesus on the cross. You know what the best thing that's ever happened is? The cross of Jesus. For in it we find forgiveness of sin. If God can take the worst sin and turn it into the best thing that ever happened, he can deal with your sin. He can and he will forgive you if you asked. Look what verse 3 and 4 says. When I kept silent about my sin, my bones wasted away. Through my groaning all day long, for day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. David said, my sin was affecting my health. It was affecting my mental health. It was affecting my physical health. I've seen this dynamic way too often. I've seen where people who have hung on to anger and bitterness have become depressed, and it just affects their whole life. Please don't hear me say that if you're experiencing depression, you must be angry and bitter. That does not track. Depression is a lot more complicated than that. But that does not take away from the fact that if you are angry and bitter, you'll likely end up depressed. I've watched a person whose disregard for their spiritual health and spiritual life has affected their mental health. And their mental health has affected their physical health. When our spiritual and mental health are not good, well, we're less resistant to viruses, we're more prone to infection. Your life and your emotional life, your spiritual life and your emotional life will affect your physical life. David said his unconfessed sin led him to decline in his emotional, physical life. He saw it as God's hand being heavy upon him. You can call that the hand of God, or natural consequences, or the discipline of God. However you look at it, unconfessed sin wreaks havoc with your life. Maybe that's where you find yourself in the psalm. You're sitting under a weight of guilt, and it is pulling the rest of your life down. You haven't dealt with it. The devil will come along and whisper in your ear, it's hopeless. But the devil is a liar and the father of lies. The good news is that your sin can be dealt with. We've been looking through the Psalms through the lens of Jesus. We'll celebrate communion in a little bit. And we're celebrating that our sins have been dealt with because of the power of the cross of Christ. He took our sin upon himself and offers his gift of righteousness to us. You can have your sins dealt with through the power of the cross. When David leads us towards the cross by showing us how to approach God with a guilty heart. Verse 5, then I acknowledge my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgression to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. David stopped trying to cover up his sin. He stopped trying to rationalize or justify his sin. He said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. What I love about this verse is, apart from the testimony that his sin is forgiven, is that up until this point in the psalm, it seems like David is talking to other. Blessed is the one whose sin is forgiven. Blessed is the one whose transgressions is forgiven, whose sin the Lord does not take into account. But now at this point, he can't help turning his heart and his expression towards God himself. I acknowledge my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Personal relationship is there. Confession to God brings that personal relationship. And it starts by confession. It starts by refusing to hide from God any longer. And God is so gracious. He's always faithful to forgive sin. Reminds me of what John the Apostle said, 1 John 1, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, then we make him out to be a liar and his word is not in us. My dear children, I write to you so that you will not sin, but if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sin, and not only for ours, but also for the sin of the whole world. It starts with confession. And when we confess, God is faithful to forgive. Confession means coming clean with God. God, I'm not going to try to justify my sin. I'm not going to try to hide from my sin. I'm not going to try to, I'm going to acknowledge my sin. God, you're right. I'm wrong. I'm sorry. I'm going to choose to go your way. That's confession. Maybe that's where you find yourself this morning and find yourself in this psalm. There may be some of you here this morning who have never taken that step of faith, or you know that there is something between you and God and you've been hiding from it. This morning we're going to take part in communion. I would invite you at that time to say, Lord, I'm sorry for what I've done. Please forgive me. And even in the act of taking part in communion, you are saying, Lord, I'm trusting your forgiveness and the power of the cross. David then goes on to acknowledge that when our sin is forgiven, God becomes our safe place. Verse 6. Therefore, let all the faithful pray to you while you may be found. Surely the rising of the mighty waters will not reach you. You are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble and surround me with songs of deliverance. Confessing your sins to God and becoming right with God does not remove the trouble from your life. But in those troubles, you have access to God. He says, you know, you pray, God hears. When the storms of life are blowing around you, God becomes your safe harbor. When trouble is pursuing you, God becomes our hiding place. When enemies are against you, God is our deliverer. You might remember when Jonathan, David's best friend, suspected that his father, King David, wanted to kill David, or King Saul. Jonathan's father, King Saul, wanted to kill David. Jonathan says to David, 1 Samuel chapter 19, he says this, Jonathan, next slide, oh, it's not there? Okay. Jonathan told David, my father is trying to kill you, and therefore be on your guard tomorrow morning. Stay in the secret place and hide yourself. Stay in the secret place and hide yourself. It's the same Hebrew word that's used for verse 7. You are my hiding place. God becomes our secret place, our hiding place, where you can go to him in trouble. I found it interesting that that David went from hiding from God to hiding in God. That's the power of confession and forgiveness. There's a wonderful sense of peace that comes in the middle of trouble when you can go to God in prayer and when you can sit with God in worship. And a faith arises that says about your troubles, God's got this. I can trust him in life and in death. Instead of being filled with anxiety, you notice that the songs of faith arise from your heart and mind. You know, one of the signs of being filled with the Spirit is you're singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. When you sense those songs rising in your heart, it's you know that God is surrounding you. What's he saying? You surround me with songs of deliverance. God's got this. Maybe that's where you find yourself today. You are experiencing the troubles of life. But you've learned to push into God, to make God your refuge, your hiding place. If you know the joys of your sins forgiven, I want you to know that this hiding place is your birthright. If you've been trying to face the storms of life on your own, I would encourage you, run to the Father. He's so full of grace. He'll help you to hide in him. The voice in the psalm changes again. It goes from the psalmist talking about talking to us, then talking to God. Now it moves from God talking to us. Verse 8. Here's what God says. Apparently my PowerPoint was not put together well. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. Do not be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one who trusts in him. God says, I'm going to teach you. I'm going to let you know which way you should go. I love the fact that it says, I will counsel you with my loving eye upon you. He speaks to us out of love. It says, don't be like the horse that doesn't have any understanding. It needs to be controlled by bit and bridle. When David had sinned and refused to acknowledge his sin, he said, God's hand was heavy upon me. Whether that was supernatural intervention or natural consequences to sin, it's us being controlled by the bit and the bridle. If you've ever ridden a horse with a bit in its mouth, you will know that if you pull one of the reins to the side, the horse's head will follow because the bit in its mouth makes it uncomfortable not to follow. The Lord is saying, don't be like the horse that has to be made uncomfortable in order to go the right way. Mules are stupid. You don't have to be, right? That's essentially what he's saying. Many are the woes of the wicked, but you can avoid those. In fact, you not only can avoid the judgment and the natural consequence of sin, but you'll find my unfailing love surrounding you. So what do you do when you are the people of God and have had your sins forgiven? What do you do when you are hiding in God in times of trouble? Verse 11 says this, rejoice in the Lord and be glad, you righteous. Sing, all of you who are upright in heart. That's what you do, because going back to the first verse, you are blessed. I'm going to invite the worship team to come up at this time. Where do you find yourself in this psalm? Maybe you're rejoicing that your sin is forgiven and that your rebellion and guilt has been covered and removed. It's a wonderful thing to walk in that kind of blessing. Maybe you're here with unconfessed sin in your life. You've been living under the burden of guilt. Would you deal with that today? Maybe you're here and ready to confess your sin to the Lord. If you've never given your life to the Lord, then I would invite you to do that today. If you've given your heart to the Lord, but you know that there's sin that needs to be dealt with, I'd invite you to deal with that before God today. Maybe you're in a place of trouble and you need God to be your refuge and your strength. I want you to invite you to run to the Lord this morning. My prayer is that we will all arrive at this place where we're rejoicing in the Lord and be glad. You righteous sing, all you who are upright in heart. Rejoice. Worship team is going to lead us in the chorus, "There is a Redeemer." Sing it along with us. Pray with me wherever you find yourself fitting here. Lord Jesus, thank you for the people who are here who are blessed because they know you have forgiven their sin. We want to thank you so much for that, and we celebrate that, and we'll celebrate that in communion. We want to say thank you, Lord, because you are so good. We know we don't deserve forgiveness, but you've given it to us anyways. Lord, Holy Spirit, come. Pray for those who are here with unconfessed sin. You know they haven't wanted to deal with it, but I'm asking, Lord, that you would give them the courage and the boldness and the help. Say, Lord, I'm sorry. Help them to walk into new life in you. Help them to confess their sin to you and walk away from it. Lord, I pray for those who've never given their hearts to the Lord. I ask you, Lord, that you would just call their name, even as they're here saying, I want to come to you. I want you to come to me. So, Lord, I'm praying that they would open their lives to you, that they would know you. Lord, I pray for those who find themselves in trouble. I pray that they would find you as their refuge. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. The worship team is going to lead us in How Deep the Father's Love.
Beyond all measure, that
Communion in our church is open to anyone who knows the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior, the one who has forgiven their sins. Or if you're here today and you've never invited Jesus into your life, or you're saying, I want to, then I would invite you to take part of communion as an act of faith, saying, Jesus, I give you my sin, and I receive your forgiveness. I'm going to follow after you. The Bible instructs us that, you know, if there's unconfessed sin in our life, then we shouldn't take part in communion. But we've walked through confession already. I trust that you've made things right with God. Paul said, I received from the Lord that which I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and after he gave thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body which is broken for you. Take, eat, in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is for you and for many. Take and drink in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The cross of Christ was the best thing that ever happened, because in it, Jesus took our sin and gave us his righteousness. And he extends that gift to every single person on earth. I will take your sin and give you my righteousness. What you're saying when you take part in communion is you're saying, I receive that gift. I have and I do. I receive that gift. Lord Jesus, this bread that we're about to take, this cup that we're about to take in, we consecrate it to you. Asking, Lord Jesus, that you would use it to encourage our heart, strengthen our souls, feed our spirits. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Communion ushers are going to come. Please hold on to the elements until we're ready to take part in them together.
Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was a sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Please open and take out the wafer. Jesus loved you so much that he went to the cross for you so that you would know what it means to be blessed, with sins forgiven, with life made new. Take, eat, remembering what Christ has done for you. Open the cup, please. Jesus' life was poured out. He experienced death so that we might know real life. Taking part in this says, Lord, you've given me life. I'm trusting life. I'm trusting you. I'm going to walk with you. Take, drink, remembering what Christ has done for you. And Lord, we give thanks because you're so good. Amen. Stand with us, please. Wonderful to celebrate God's love for us together. God bless you as you go. There's a time of fellowship out in the back hall if you want to join us for coffee and snacks. But God bless you as you walk about this coming week. Know that his presence goes with you. Go in God.